Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 15th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda is to agree or not to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The second item on our agenda is further consideration of the Auditor General's briefing on the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. And we're pleased to be joined in the committee room this morning by three witnesses. First of all, the Director General of Economy in the Scottish Government, Gregor Irwin. Good morning. Mr. Irwin is joined by Aidan Griswood, who is the Director of Jobs and Wellbeing Economy in the Scottish Government. He's also joined by Colin Cook, who's the Director of Economic Development in the Scottish Government. We've got quite a number of questions to put to you this morning, Director General, but before we get to those, can I invite you to make a statement to the committee?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to provide evidence to the committee today. NSET has an explicit focus on delivery, and 2 years in, we have made good progress. To date, we've completed 17 of the actions identified in NSET, with a further 44 currently progressing. Our achievements include investment of £42 million in our national tech scaler network to support the next generation of startups, more than 25,000 houses connected through our R100 programme, and setting up and now implementing the recommendations of the First Minister's investor panel. There is, of course, always more to do, particularly as this is a 10-year strategy. NSET was always designed to be flexible to ensure maximum impact on our economic performance and value for money. We've learnt and continue to learn what works well and areas where we can improve. Audit Scotland's report is timely as we consider refreshing NSET 2 years after the strategy was first introduced. The recommendations on monitoring, evaluation, the use of targets, these are all important and helpful to us. Now, as part of that work on NSET, we're examining its governance and preparing advice for our ministers so that we can ensure that this continues to meet the highest standards while being proportionate. We are, of course, at a moment of transition ministerially. That process is mid-flight, and of course that will have an implication for what we're able to say to you today, but we will do everything possible to address your questions. And if I could just say that as accountable officer, the importance of Audit Scotland's work in this area to me, it really does matter a great deal, so I'm very grateful for that.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. And just taking up your last point about the work of Audit Scotland really mattering, do you accept the conclusions and recommendations in the Auditor General's briefing?
So we absolutely welcome the recommendations. We're going to address these as part of the advice that we give to our new ministers as we approach this question of refreshing the NSET strategy. The report does provide quite detailed and specific advice in a number of areas. Be very happy to go into the detail of that. As I say, in many areas, it very much aligns with our thinking, and it will align with the advice that we put to ministers, but we still need to progress that with ministers. But the report is extremely helpful and useful for us.
If you don't mind me saying so, Director General, that's a rather ambiguous answer. I mean, do you accept the recommendations and do you accept the conclusions of the Auditor General on NSET?
We accept the broad thrust of the recommendations. There are one or two detailed specific areas where, you know, I could give you examples where perhaps we might want to probe a little bit more deeply, but we welcome the report and accept the broad thrust of the recommendations. I could give you examples, if you would like, of where we might want to just probe a little bit more in the detail.
Yes, well, we'll probably get to those, and I'm sure people will draw their own conclusions from your answers. Can I take you to the very first key message in the briefing which is before us, which talks about key message three, talks about political leadership and the gap in political leadership, in particular, that the government said in, I think, 2022, it was going to establish an economic leadership group chaired by the First Minister, and it has yet to meet. Could you explain that for us, please?
Yes. So it is absolutely true that the economic leadership group has not met as originally planned. The reason for that initially was because of the challenge of getting ministerial diaries to align and to find the appropriate moment to have the meeting of that group. There has certainly been collective ministerial oversight of NSET and very substantial involvement of ministers over the course of the past 2 years. The delivery boards, which is a core part of the governance of NSET, is co-chaired by the Cabinet Secretary, now Deputy First Minister, for the economy. That role is a key role in terms of providing an escalation route to the Cabinet and to for engagement with ministers right across government. So there are a number of ways in which we've had ministerial oversight of NSET, including bilaterally the Cabinet Secretary engaging with ministers and Cabinet Secretaries in other portfolios. I'd be happy to explain more about how that's worked in practice. Also in ministerial groups such as the Public Sector and Economy Ministerial Group, now replaced by the Performance and Delivery Ministerial Group, which is chaired by the previous Deputy First Minister, which has addressed NSET issues in a number of areas. Now, that doesn't change the fact that the Economic Leadership Group has not met, and that was an action in NSET, and that hasn't happened, but there's been many other ways in which there's been collective ministerial oversight of NSET.
Okay, but sorry, did you say earlier on in your answer that this was an issue about coordinating diaries?
That was a challenge initially when we, the team before my time when I joined the Scottish Government, when looking to establish that group. Aidan may be able to expand more on that if that is useful.
Mr. Griswood?
Yeah, happy to. So just getting a date fixed. So there was a date fixed, and then, unfortunately, the First Minister, another priority came up and wasn't able to take that forward. So there's just a period of time. It was only ever going to meet twice a year. There's obviously a lot of work early on in setting up the governance throughout. And, you know, as Greg has said, a year in, there's actually quite a lot of change in terms of just the overall governance across SG and the ministerial accountability overall, including things like, as we said, the Public Services and Economy Ministerial Group that oversaw economy matters across the piece, and we had a number of cross-cutting portfolio issues that went to that group for discussion. And also, with the previous First Minister, set up a whole process around accountability direct to him on mandate commitments through the policy prospectus, and a regular process of accountability direct to Cabinet Secretaries on that. And that included core NSET commitments within it. So there was a process, I suppose, of evolution and just making sure too, and I guess thinking forward, you know, in terms of governance, how do we get that cross-government oversight of this that in a way that marries with other governance arrangements across the piece, so make sure that we're not duplicating or confusing in terms of that accountability.
Yeah, we'll get on to duplication later on. So the leadership group has not met, even though it was a central part of the strategy for economic transformation. Can you remind me again who is on, or who is supposed to be on, the economic leadership group?
Are you able to?
So in terms of Cabinet Secretaries, obviously Cabinet Secretaries' portfolios has changed over the period of the last 2 years, but it was key Cabinet Secretaries who had responsibility for actions within NSET at the time, and also the COSLA President as well. So that was set out in the accountability framework that was shared with you, I think.
So you weren't able to coordinate the diaries of half a dozen at the most cabinet secretaries and the president of COSLA to fix up a meeting of the economic leadership group. I mean, the Auditor General told us on the 14th of March that the economic leadership group was a key part of the government's NSET accountability framework. So I'm struggling to understand why it hasn't met. And I don't know, you know, I don't know who can answer that question.
Well, I think one of the reasons why I sense the immediacy of the need to set that up is diminished over time is because there have been alternative ways in which that oversight, ministerial oversight of NSET has been provided.
So is the economic leadership group being scrapped?
We will be putting advice to our ministers, the new ministerial team, on future governance of NSET, where we will look at all aspects of governance, but this is one area that we will specifically look at.
Okay, so there's a possibility there will be no leadership group in the future. There hasn't really been one in the past either, has there, in practice? But
we need to put that advice to our ministers and to address that with them at the appropriate time.
Okay. As part of the revision, are you taking into account the termination of the Bute House Agreement?
Right across government, termination of the Bute House agreement will be a factor in considering policy choices of the new ministerial team. So I think that is true in all policy areas. But the new ministerial team is only just being assembled, the approach that we'll take to that is will be subject to advice to those new ministers once they're fully in position.
Sorry, when you say new ministerial team, do you mean the First Minister? Because the Cabinet Secretary responsible for the economy remains the same, doesn't it?
No, it's the new Deputy First Minister who's responsible for the economy.
Okay. So there may well be then a revision in light of the Bute House Agreement being terminated, I would speculate, but you may not need to answer that, Director General. Can I just also turn to a point I raised with the Auditor General? And I know you weren't in post at the time, Mr. Irwin, but I was struggling a little bit to understand why the previous strategy, the 2015 strategy, was not updated in light of the Brexit vote in 2016. I mean, that quite clearly is a potential economic shock and a change to the framework in which you work. And, of course, the UK left the European Union in January 2020, and there was no reset of the strategy at that point either. Can you offer any explanation why that would have been?
So the previous strategy from 2018? The previous strategy from when?
Well, there was a strategy that was launched in 2015.
2015 strategy. I don't know if either of my colleagues can help with that. I suppose I would say that the principle of ensuring that your strategy is current and that it's focused in the right areas and that it takes account of changing external circumstances, the new opportunities and the new challenges that presents, that is important. And it's certainly part of our current thinking as we look at the potential to refresh NSET.
Okay. Just one final thing from me before I pass over to the Deputy Convener, and that is you will see in Exhibit 1 of the Auditor General's briefing, he gives examples of NSET actions, which are lifted directly from the government strategy. And it includes Action 6, create a national system of pre-scaler hubs that will stimulate the very earliest stages of high-growth commercial and social entrepreneurship. Action 15, build strategic partnerships with other key entrepreneurial ecosystems in other countries. I mean, what does that mean?
I might ask Mr. Cook to address that.
I understand the point, because I obviously I saw your the questions you put to the Auditor General and suggested that that was jargon, and I accept that to some audiences it would be seen as jargon. For those working within the ecosystem, if I may, of organisations that support economic development in Scotland, it's a very recognisable term. So the pre-scalers are those, are organisational constructs that help people start a business, to help them think through how they deal with all the legal necessities that come with starting a business and, you know, develop a marketing plan and look forward to a future. The international links are the strategy around entrepreneurship is to position Scotland as a startup nation. That means that we need to look externally, compare ourselves to other countries, and to make links to other countries who are going down similar routes. And that's what it refers to. It refers to the links to countries such as you know, Lithuania and Estonia, who are known to be at the forefront of entrepreneurship.
Okay, I'm not sure many people would describe themselves as pre-scalers. and I have to confess, Mr. Cook, it sounds less like jargon and more like gobbledygook to me. But anyway, I'm, you don't have to answer that.
We take the point and we'll make sure that our terminology appeals.
Okay, well, I'm glad that we've made a difference on the Public Audit Committee. Deputy Convener Jamie Green's got some questions for you. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. Let's go back to where we started. If you look at page 11 of the Auditor General's report, paragraph 17, the opening line states that the Director General for Economy is the accountable officer for delivery of the NSET. Now, I appreciate you gave a brief opening statement which claimed that progress has been made, but you're yet to convince me of such. So as the accountable officer in charge of delivery of NSET, in what way have you made progress?
So I would say that we've made significant progress. There is obviously room to make further progress. Of the actions set out in NSET, 17 are complete, 44 are in progress. I would suggest that key achievements include that investment in the tech scaler network that I referred to before. We now have 7 regional hubs fully operational. They're providing education programs, mentoring and support, incubation spaces for over 700 founders. So that's real practical help and support. Also over 2,700 community members. We've launched Scotland's migration service that was launched just last month. That's helping to address, if you like, the demographic challenge and the challenges that we face in a declining workforce. It's a really important economic challenge for Scotland. It's about getting the best out of what's possible within the current migration system. I think we've made really good progress on fair work conditionality. That means that recipients of public sector grants are now required to pay at least the real living wage. And the coverage of the real living wage is high. Can also, obviously, there's still room for it to be higher still. I would also point to, I mentioned the First Minister's investor panel. The commitment in NSET was to establish the panel. We established the panel. We worked with the panel so that they could produce their recommendations. They've now done that. We've accepted the recommendations. We now have an implementation plan and are working through the implementation of those recommendations. So you can see a single small action within NSET has produced a whole work programme that we're now diligently working through. And again, that's addressing a really important challenge for Scotland, which is to make sure that we are really competitive in attracting internationally mobile capital. And that links into other areas such as the whole challenge of ensuring that we are investing to support the net zero transition and the opportunities that presents. I could point to other examples. I'll just point to one more, which is the opening of the National Manufacturing Institute, a really good bit of infrastructure which is helping to promote growth in our manufacturing industry. And a really good example of how the government, in partnership with others, can make a practical difference.
And that's all good work, and I think it's to be commended. And you can't detract from positives in that respect. But I think from our point of view, reflecting on the Auditor General's commentary, and I will come on to some of the specifics, there are two things that have jumped out that were flagged by the Auditor General which seem to have come to pass. And one was the clear inability to monitor progress through specific targets and the lack of political leadership. Now, in the first 20 minutes, we've heard there's clearly a lack of political leadership. You're obviously the accountable officer. You're not accountable for ministers and what they do, but we certainly haven't seen political leadership in this respect in the last 2 years. But the others, and you've mentioned some of them, is it's very hard to measure success if you don't know what you're measuring against. Why do you think there were no clear, specific economic output metrics or targets that NSET were working towards? And if you could enlighten me, for example, how many jobs have been created through the strategy? How has GDP improved? How has productivity improved? How many new startups are there? And how much has economic growth actually occurred as a result of the strategy? And if we don't know that, it's very difficult to say if you've been successful or not.
So I might turn to Mr. Griswood on the question of metrics in a moment. But in the question of political leadership, I would suggest that there really has been quite strong and consistent political leadership. It has not come through the economic leadership group, which has not met, but it has been very evident in a number of other areas, and that includes the work of the Cabinet Secretary on the NSET delivery boards. It includes the work of successive Cabinet Secretaries working bilaterally with other ministers. Just recently, for example, Ms. McCallan, who was our Cabinet Secretary until very recently, she met with the former Deputy First Minister to address the question of how the medium-term financial strategy, which is currently in preparation, how NSET will relate to that and what opportunities there are there. As Aidan has mentioned, it is very clear in the policy prospectus and through mandate letters and through the commitments which have been created for individual Cabinet Secretaries, how that relates to NSET. And then, of course, there are other ministerial groups, including now the Performance and Delivery Ministerial Group, where there is ministerial oversight of NSET. So that political leadership is there. It has come in many different forms. The Cabinet Secretary for the Economy, now the Deputy First Minister, is a core person in providing that leadership and ensuring that it is coherent.
So before we come on to targets and metrics, because they are important and it's an area of questioning we do want to go into, but at what point, as you in charge of the strategy, did you not flag with either the First Minister or someone senior in government and say, guys, you've got to sit around the table and have a meeting? You know, how can 2 years pass and colleagues who sit next to each other in the parliamentary chamber not sit next to each other in a civil service room somewhere and say, what progress are we making on the strategy? You know, it's just that they had meetings, but you weren't party to them. Did you not flag to them that this was important? Were you not chasing them for meetings? And at what point did you say this isn't working?
So very much part of those meetings that I've just described and those processes, and indeed officials are part of the Performance and Delivery Ministerial Group. I think it's fair to say that as Director General's Accountable Officer, I have not felt starved of ministerial attention when it comes to NSET. Equally, we've acknowledged already, more than 2 years into NSET, it is appropriate to take stock of what has worked, what is working, and what could be improved. And we will, of course, put advice to our ministers, including on this question of governance.
So if you scrap the Economic Leadership Group, what do you think you would replace it with? What would be a suitable way to oversee the delivery of the strategy?
So I wouldn't at this stage want to speculate on the advice that we'll provide to our new ministerial team, but we'll build on what works well and we'll seek to improve that and seek to ensure that the governance is proportionate but also absolutely effective in delivering that collective ministerial oversight of NSET.
Okay. Mr. Griswood, in what way numerically has Scotland's economy improved the result of your strategy?
So the economy covers everything, and as you'll be aware, and even just sort of referencing earlier the point about Brexit and the impact that has had, for example, on the economy overall, is something that we're still understanding and estimating. And we also had a cost crisis shortly after.
Yeah, but your publication strategy has been lauded as having had success. So, like, to what numerically, what economic success do we have?
I think what we can do is point to specific projects and within NZ and what they have achieved in terms of delivery. So we've got an evaluation program that looks at specifics. So if you look at, for example, export support, you know, there's an evaluation of that found that export sales grew by over 1.6 billion over the last few years and a further 2.7 billion expected over the subsequent 3 years. So that was an explicit sort of targeted bit of evaluation work, including some recommendations that flow from that, and similarly work done on inward investment too. So there's a number of areas, and I could talk about employability, where we've done very sort of detailed evaluations of Fair Start Scotland, but now also monitoring progress on No One Left Behind. So if you think about that labour and activity key objective within NZ, that's something that we're tracking, and we're able to look at specifically what have we done and how that's flowed through in terms of number of people receiving a service and the follow-through in terms of outcomes, in terms of getting into jobs through that. What we can't, and is much more difficult, is obviously the labour market as a whole is subjected to all sorts of external factors, economic shocks that are difficult to foresee.
Yeah.
And therefore, actually, what's the effect overall in terms of, why we were hesitant in terms of thinking about a 10-year strategy, actually be able to predict what GDP would be in the absence of NZ and what it would be, you know, is a very, very hard question.
Isn't that part of the problem, really? And it's not a direct criticism of those involved in delivery of the strategy, but you've got something that is impossible to measure because it simply feeds into a much wider macroeconomic situation. Mm-hmm. Therefore, it's very difficult to quantify whether you're doing well, whether the strategy is working, whether it's performing relative value for money, whether many of the criticisms which are in the Auditor General's report are valid or not. Isn't that an impossible task you have to prove to us, to the Auditor General, to government, that actually the strategy is working, it's worthwhile, and how on earth can you refresh something if you don't know what effect it's having on the economy?
Well, it is very difficult, and I'd say it is more difficult on something like the economy as a whole than it would be, for example, for a transport programme where you can do some modelling in advance based on previous behaviour, transport patterns, you've got reasonable expectations of what that might flow through in terms of usage and economic benefit, and then you can evaluate subsequently in terms of monitoring numbers of people going over the bridge, for example, and, you know, was that what we expected? So the economy is inherently complex. However, I think what we're trying to do is really break down that complexity. And part of that was actually thinking about the programmes themselves. So what's actually the foundations and what are the targets for each? What are the indicators for each of those programmes themselves? What's mm-hmm. important? And then what is the flow through? What's the logic chain in terms of what we're doing that could impact upon that outcome? And then we do evaluations and we do appraisals based on that. So that's a process that we've started doing. So logic mapping against each of those programs, what's the flow through from what we're doing through to the outcome, and then actually putting in place metrics that reflect what we're achieving against the outcome. And I think importantly, and something we're learning as we go along, can we think of those interim steps? So what's the sort of steps on the way that allow us to say confidently, we've got a line of sight to where we want to get to, but actually we need to track delivery in terms of the progress on the way to that. So that example I gave on employability is a good example. We're actually developing our infrastructure and capability to actually measure progress. What's the money going in? What's the outputs? What's the impact? And actually all parts of the chain so we can sort of track that and report back on that accordingly.
The risk there is that you're riding on the coattails of other things that were happening anyway. In the opening statement, I heard that the rollout of R100 was one of your great successes. Well, that was happening anyway. It was a government project and funded centrally from the UK government. So, of course, it was going to happen at some point. But whether or not that's a measure of success of NSAIR or not is debatable. And on that note, Director General, apologies if I don't use the specific wording, but I think you said you welcome the recommendations of Audit Scotland's report and accepted the broad thrust. Now, that, as the convener mentioned, doesn't sound entirely like an acceptance of the recommendations. So I'd like you to be specific. Which of the comments, phrases, criticisms, recommendations or summaries of the Audit Scotland report do you not agree with, and why?
I think the specific example that I draw your attention to is the question of whether there is an escalation. A route for the delivery board to escalate major delivery concerns. That route most definitely exists, and the route is the cabinet secretary who co-chairs.
Let's point to page 10 of the report. There's a very helpful.
Sorry, I'm looking at page 5.
Okay.
The recommendations.
This is a nice visual version of it, and in the middle we have the dotted lines between the NSET delivery board and the economic leadership group, which we know has been a failure. But below that, there's the relationship between the NSET portfolio board and the programmes and the economic strategy unit, and then the Scottish cabinet and corporate governance within different DGs. And it's that bit in the middle, the dotted square, that says no formal connection set out in NSET accountability framework. Now, that's the missing link, and it's the key missing link, but you're saying it's not.
If I can explain. If I could draw your attention to page 5 and the first bullet. So the recommendation is to establish the Economic Leadership Forum as set out in the NSET accountability framework, or put in alternative mechanisms to provide the planned political leadership of the strategy and routes for the delivery board to escalate major delivery concerns. Now, I would say that route to escalate major delivery concerns exists, and that route has been provided by the Cabinet Secretary, now the Deputy First Minister, as co-chair of the delivery board. And alternative mechanisms are in place, have been in place, to provide the planned political leadership, and that includes the combination of mandate letters that flows from the policy prospectus, which sets out commitments of individual cabinet secretaries. It includes bilateral engagement between the cabinet secretary for the economy and those other cabinet secretaries. It includes the work of the public sector and economy ministerial group, which has now become the performance and delivery ministerial group, and ultimately includes the cabinet itself. Now, the question that you may still ask is, well, is that the best alternative mechanism, given that the Economic Leadership Forum has not met? And that is a question that yes, we believe that we can and should, 2 years into the strategy, as part of a review of how it's functioning, take stock and provide advice to our ministers to ensure that we get that right.
So either the Auditor General was incorrect in his analysis of the arrangements, or what you're saying doesn't exist. One of those must be true.
Well, what I'm suggesting is that both the planned escalation route and an alternative mechanism to provide political leadership has been in place and is in place. Okay. And of course, there is potentially room for improvement, and periodically it is just good practice to test whether the system is working as well as it could do. It is not working as originally envisaged, as set out in page 10 of the report, and that is factually absolutely correct. But that is our assessment of how it works in practice at the moment.
Okay. And I think the importance of the Economic Leadership Group has unearthed itself in the course of this meeting already, and I'm sure it's regrettable that it failed to take the leadership that it was given in its due place, and I'm sure that's something you'll consider moving forward. I'm sure colleagues will have other areas of interest of where you, it sounds like you may not particularly agree with the outcomes of the Audit Scotland report, and I'm sure we'll elicit those from you over the course of the rest of the meeting. Convener, I'm happy to pass on to colleagues.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to invite Colin Beattie to put some questions to you. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Money, probably the most important element in the mix here. You talk about funding, you talk about investment, not necessarily the same thing, of course. Your annual report references 9.8 billion of investment, but there's no detail. How much money is needed to deliver NSET plans? You know, where's the funding coming from?
If I may start to answer your question, I may ask Mr. Griswood to come in as well, as he's also our finance director and heavily involved in this part of NSET. So, as has already been emphasised, of course, NSET is a 10-year strategy. It is not a strategy that lends itself to being set up at the outset and then very clearly at that point identifying everything that needs to be done for that strategy to be successful and then to cost it and to put in place budgets for that. And that is for a number of different reasons. Some of the actions in NSET quite naturally are well-defined and lend themselves to being easily costed. For example, the tech scaler program. There are others which are more open-ended and less well-defined at the onset, and that is appropriate. That is entirely correct. The example I've used already is the work of the investor panel. The NSET action was to establish the investor panel, which was a relatively straightforward step to take. But the implicit consequence of that, of course, is that we then follow through and we address the recommendations of the investor panel and then implement those recommendations. And some elements of those recommendations do, of course, have a financial cost that was not foreseeable when NSET was originally envisaged. So any strategy, any comprehensive, ambitious strategy that's seeking to reach across governments, but which is also multi-year, extending well beyond the normal budgeting horizon of governments, needs to be flexible and adaptable. And as part of that, it needs to adapt to external circumstances as well. You know, if you look back over 2.5 years to when NSET was on the verge of being launched, we've gone through a cost of living crisis, a lurch in inflation and interest rates upwards, and now, thankfully, downwards. The external environment that we're operating in has become even more complex geopolitically, but also with economic consequences. This has had fiscal consequences for the government, created new challenges. So, of course, that in addition also has impacted on our ability to support all aspects of the programme.
You might not be able to tell me what it's going to cost in 10 years' time, but you must have some idea of the issues you're working on, the things you're working on, how much that's going to cost and where the funding is going to come from. I mean, I would have thought this was right up front that you'd be looking at funding for these projects. Otherwise, they're not going to happen. Now, this can only come from private investment or from government. So how is this being managed?
No, absolutely. I will let Mr. Griswood come in. But of course, the normal budgeting process each year is absolutely key to ensuring that we have adequate funding for the NSET programme each year, in addition to resource spending reviews, which give us a multi-year perspective. And indeed, we have the medium-term financial strategy, which is due to be published soon. But I'll let Mr. Griswood come in.
Yes, so just on that, so NSET does play a key part in terms of thinking about the priorities for budget and PFG. So in terms of internal process at the resource spending review, we actually went through NSET itself in terms of just looking at every single policy commitment across the piece in government and identifying which was an NSET commitment. So that played into prioritisation. It was a very tough prioritisation because of the overall financial envelope we had to play with, but that marker saying this is an NSET project, you know, was something that was factored in terms of decisions about priorities overall. So that was a process where it actually did influence, had a role in sort of informing those decisions. And then more recently, you know, decisions, for example, about the prioritisation of offshore wind, so programme for government commitments around that, or indeed the work on enterprise that Mr. Cook mentioned earlier. These are sort of core parts of NSET. So they come with options in terms of the scale of those projects and how quickly you want to take those forward, which we then need to feed in to that budget. And they also come with evidence around to support those decisions, because those decisions need to be backed by reasonable evidence that could justify that expenditure. So there's a load of processes there, but I guess that inherent flexibility, when we don't know the overall fiscal envelope, when you're talking about a programme as big as an economic transformation programme that crosses so many different areas, you inevitably have to retain that flexibility. And I think actually the Deputy First Minister, when she was at the Economic and Fair Work Committee shortly after publication, said explicitly that the strategy has to be flexible and high level enough to adapt to emerging situations. So I think that's an inevitable part of a 10-year programme. You need to have that broad vision perspective. You need to have a pipeline, and you need to be flexible in adapting what comes through those through that pipeline of projects. But when you get to that point of actually making a decision, we're going to go ahead with that, you have to be confident that you've got that what you're doing is affordable, impactful and deliverable. And that's where NZ in particular is really important in terms of those metrics of success and the work I was talking about earlier about evaluation, but also those disciplines that we have internally as part of the budget process to make sure that we've got the money to follow through.
My concern is that in all you've said, you haven't mentioned a single figure. You haven't given any indication of what the scale of the funding that's going to be needed at any stage in this. You surely must have something that you've got there, some idea as to what the funding is going to be this year, next year, short term, even if you can't do long term. So where's the money coming from and where's it going?
So we do work, and as part of the budget, part of our role is making sure not just for the portfolio, our own portfolio that we're supporting, it's also looking across the piece and saying, what is it that we're doing on the economy across the piece? So what is it that's part and parcel of delivering that economic transformation? So that played into, for example, we were confident in estimating that over £5 billion of capital that was put in the budget was going to deliver economic transformation. And we did the work around that in terms of skills, in terms of housing, in terms of transport, in terms of the offshore wind commitment. So we play into that in terms of informing choices at the budget, making sure that the overall package is aligned with what we're trying to do in terms of economic transformation. And as I say, being able to cost that in a particular year. What we don't have is an overall estimate of the entire NZ programme and all those actions, because a lot of those are inherently, they're not yet fully scoped, and we don't necessarily have a timescale for all of those, partly because we don't yet know what the overall envelope is. And those are choices that we need to present ministers at times of budget when decisions are made.
But you must have some idea as to the funding needs. I mean, you're not giving me any impression at all as to where this funding is going to come from and the scale of it and where there might be potential shortfalls, where there's a struggle to put the cash together to achieve what's needed. I'm just not hearing any of that.
So there are certainly challenges, and I think, again, the former Deputy First Minister, when in front of the Economy and Fair Work Committee talking about NZ and also the budget, was very transparent about choices that had to be made as part of the emergency budget review, for example, including on NZ programmes, so the reduction in funding for employability at that point as a consequence of funding. So there is that openness, including in the delivery plans, around things that are being taken forward and things that are being paused. I think the overall programme, in terms of overall scale, I mean, we are talking across the piece here, multi-billion pounds, but over 10 years. So things like take your digital rollout, what's the next stage of that, going beyond, 5G, that's at the moment is something that needs to be fleshed out. It's reliant in part upon UK government funding, as mentioned earlier. Or you take the transport programme, for example, which again is an NZ action. That is a huge programme, lots of different issues within that. To quantify the entirety of that and be able to do that confidently over the next, 5-6 years, you're very much, that's something that has a degree of inherent uncertainty around it.
But I mean, you can't be stumbling forward blind without knowing what the costings are going to be, where the money is going to come from. And I'm hearing nothing. I mean, you're giving me process, you're giving me, you know, a lot of verbiage around it, but at the end of the day, there's no hard facts there on where the funding's coming from, whether it's going to be private, whether it's going to be government, where particularly shortfalls, potential shortfalls could be in place. I would have expected all that to be, you know, a key piece of information that would be at your fingertips.
Yeah, and I think because of just the nature of the programme and the scale of it and its longevity, we can't have that level of detail. But what we do have is detail on what we are taking forward through the budget process that supports the economy, so we can identify that. I think on this, that there's also work we did, I should say, to track expenditure, and we're quite open about that, and it came out in the report that we're in the process of changing our systems internally. So just that process of being able to identify what is an NZ action, get the cost for that across the piece, and be able to track that, that is something that we looked into and made a choice that actually the systems, as things stand, couldn't support that level of analysis in a proportionate way. But I think the confidence we have is that through the PFG, in terms of setting priorities and a budget, you know, we are in a position to make decisions collectively and advise on that around what's important for the economy, what's the package overall, and what's the cost of that, and is it affordable? And then through the resource spending review process, which is that multi-year process, again, we identified across the piece what is an NZ action, and that informed difficult choices around the resource spending review and what was taken forward over multi-year. And as we know then, since then, that financial envelope has changed again because of economic, economic events.
So did you want to come in?
Yes, thank you. If I may, I think you've raised an important point about the balance between private finance and public finance. And I think that also speaks to the inherent difficulty of being able to say, to put firm figures on the scale of public financing that is required. So just to give you an example, I've referred to the work of the investor panel previously. The investor panel was asked to advise on how we can make Scotland more competitive in attracting internationally mobile capital, specifically with a focus on net zero transition, but you know, really linked to ensuring that we exploit fully the opportunities from offshore wind. So this is a core part of what we're trying to do in the New Market Opportunities Programme of NSET. Having been through that process with the investor panel, having taken their recommendations and now implementing them, that is allowing us to shift that balance between public financial supports and private financial supports. And part of our challenge there is to leverage that public financial commitment, which is very significant, at £67 million of capital spending in this financial year for offshore winds, but to leverage that to do the best possible job of bringing in private finance alongside that. The idea that we could establish 18 months ago or 2 years ago or 2.5 years ago exactly what the balance would be between private finance and public finance in that exercise, I don't think that would have been possible. But actually, we can see in the light of that work how we should progress and how we can get maximum impact, maximum value for money for the public funding that is being committed to that, including £67 million this year.
I have to say I find it disappointing that there's a lack of detail around the funding, and I think maybe it's something that needs to be pursued to try and get, for the committee to get some understanding as to how this is all working, because I'm none the wiser than when I first started asking the question. I know a bit more about process, but I don't have any real grip still of what the figures are. But let me ask you, I'll move on from that. There's obviously connections needed across Scottish Government, different directorates and so on. How do the directorates work together to agree on shared NSET priorities, funding priorities? How does that work? How do you prioritise?
So the portfolio boards that I chair brings together director generals from the most directly relevant parts of governments. That provides a vehicle for us to identify where the challenges in delivering on NSET priorities are greatest, where there are funding challenges and how they might be resolved, and through that to ensure that our advice to our ministers really does reflect NSET in the prioritisation work that goes on in preparation for not just the budget but other important points as part of the broader fiscal decision-making process, whether it's a resource spending review or the medium-term financial strategy. So the portfolio boards provides that means to look across different parts of government, but ultimately it's through the budget process itself and related fiscal processes that those trade-offs are addressed.
The budget process, yes, I can understand prioritisation happens there, but there must be ongoing discussions between the directorates, as in when opportunities arise, as in when perhaps there's gaps in the funding and you have to prioritise where you're going to plug these gaps and who's going to be prioritised. So there must be something ongoing.
That's a constant process, and of course that's how government works and that's how good government should work. We should be constantly probing whether we're delivering best value for money. As and when new opportunities emerge, we need to exploit those. I don't know if you want to come in.
I mean, as Greg has just said, I mean, it's very much part of the DNA of how government works, that cross-directorate discussion, consultation, agreement, reprioritisation. For an example, one of the actions that is committed to within NSET is the development of what is described as a net zero industrial strategy within NSET, or a green industrial strategy. It tends to be called to sort of de-jargonize it, if I may. That is a collaborative piece of work between teams working in Gregor's DG area and teams working in the DG area represented by Roy Brannan, that looks at the environmental side of the government's business. So that's a joint piece of work that we share ideas and we will come forward with a joint recommendation to ministers on.
If I may, just to sort of build on that example, we've just been through a very difficult budget process, as I'm sure you're aware. And as part of the Wednesday portfolio, even though in DG Economy the responsibility for offshore wind doesn't sit within DG Economy, offshore wind is really important for NSET. It's absolutely central to our ability to deliver in the New Market Opportunities Programme. But within those budget discussions, we absolutely sought to prioritise funding for offshore wind because we recognise that now is a critical moment to seize the opportunities from attracting investment into offshore wind and the related supply chain. So that's an example of really sort of, you know, difficult decision making and trade-offs and prioritisation being made at official level to support our ministers and their decision making. And that's how it works in practice.
Okay. I'm going to leave it there in connection with funding, but I have to say that, you know, I can't say the responses I've had I feel are very satisfactory. I'd like to just say that now. Thank
you. Okay, thanks, Colin. I'm now going to invite Willie Coffey to see how much satisfaction he can get. Willie.
Let's put it to the test, Convener. Thank you very much and good morning. I wanted to ask you about reporting and evaluation plans, but firstly, I want to return to a point made by one of my colleagues earlier on the rollout of the broadband programme, and I think he suggested that it was the UK government that funded that. As we all know, the Scottish government funded this, despite it being a reserved UK matter, to the tune of about £600 million. And if memory serves me rightly, the UK's contribution to that was £49 million, about 10% of that input from the Scottish Government. Firstly, Gregor, could you confirm that those figures are reasonably accurate?
I don't know if either Aidan or... I'm afraid don't have that to hand. Your characterisation seems reasonable to me, but I'm looking at Colin to see whether...
I don't have the figures to hand for the R100 programme. I do think it's fair to say that the rollout of broadband has been a joint initiative between Scottish Government, UK Government, and in many cases, and significant contributions from Scottish local government over many years. So it's always been approached as a collaborative exercise.
If you'd like, we could write to you with confirmation of those figures.
Yep, that would be appreciated. On the other hand, the UK government's planned Project Gigabit scheme, which is a £5 billion scheme, suggests that the consequential to Scotland on that will be some £450 million to take many of these premises to gigabit capacity. Have we got the money yet? Does Scotland have that money yet?
I'm afraid I'm unable to answer that question directly.
So this is the future years as well, isn't it? So my understanding is that's work's been done at the moment in terms of developing a business case around that next phase, gigabit rollout, and that's obviously going to play in terms of any refresh of the strategy that we undertake. So digital colleagues are working on that, and that includes sources of funding around all of that, but that's been developed, so it will still need to go through decisions about how much is allocated and decisions about prioritisation will still need to go through that process in order to for it to be confirmed.
Okay, I mean, it's been around for a wee while. Yeah. It's not like yesterday's news, Project Gigabit. It's been around for a wee while, so I would have expected some part of that consequential to have arrived on our doorsteps by this time, but I'd appreciate if you can update the committee if and when that happens. Thank you for that. On the reporting and evaluation side of things, Gregor, you were telling us in your opening remarks that you're refreshing and reviewing quite a number of these things. And while colleagues have been chatting, I've been having a look at the NSET report from last June. But the Auditor General tells us that the briefing highlights a lack of detail in when some actions are expected to be delivered. And I can see that through the NSET report from last June. It's full of things called ambition indicators, which are maybe a little bit of jargon again for the committee members. So it's not clear, perhaps, to committee members and perhaps anyone else what is meant by that and really what the outcomes for some of these actions have been. You've spent a little bit of time telling us about some of the positive deliverables that have occurred there, but why wouldn't we begin to see them in a formal report like that so we can see clearly the outcomes and benefits and so forth? So could you just kind of comment generally about the style and nature of reporting and evaluation and whether we think that style of reporting is clear enough for everyone to understand?
So I might bring in Mr. Griswood in a moment on the question. On the question of the annual report and the nature of that report and whether and how we could improve that. I do think there is, and this is an area where I think Audit Scotland's is one of the many areas where I think Audit Scotland's recommendations are right. I think there are questions, valid questions to be asked about the specificity of outcomes and actions and the timing associated with those actions, which, quite naturally, I think at this stage in NSET, more than 2 years into a 10-year strategy, we ought to be able to provide more specificity there. And that is one of the issues that we want to raise with our ministers as part of a refresh, and with the caveat that we have not yet had the opportunity to discuss this with our new cabinet secretary. But 2 years in, I think it's quite legitimate to suggest that we should be able to be more specific in explaining the timeline for some, not all of those actions, because some of them are by their very nature, sort of further down the sequence, the sort of natural sequence with which you wish to take those actions. And then, of course, as I've mentioned already, some of those actions beget other actions, in fact, programmes, additional programmes, such as the investor panel work, the Withers review of the skills delivery landscape being another example, the green industrial strategy work. But the more specific, I think the challenge of ensuring that we are being specific, both in terms of outcomes and actions, is an important one. But if I could bring in Mr. Griswood to address the question of how the annual report addresses this. Yeah.
No, I think that's a helpful steer. I would agree with that in terms of needing to move on from reporting on delivery and those high-level metrics towards bringing into the annual report some of that evidence around what have we done and what's the impact in terms of the commentary as well as the data around that. So I think just to recognise, I think as this develops, we shouldn't necessarily just always default to the previous format of the annual report as it matures and our knowledge matures and our and hopefully our capability in terms of being able to identify that improves. I think that report needs to develop. So I think that's a fair comment.
Yeah, we love time frames and targets at the Audit Committee. So we live by these, and clearly we make judgments, and the public will make judgments on whether the government has met these. So the closer you can get to things like that, while they're helpful targets, the better, I think, for us. So if we're looking forward, convener, to the next report, having that kind of reshaped reporting mechanism and reporting and time frames and targets that can be achieved and have been achieved, I think would be of great benefit. But and allied to that, Gregor, I would like to ask about the regional dimension to all of this. So I represent Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley. It's the Nearshore. And my constituents say to me, what's in this for us? So all that I have to look at in the Auditor General's report and some of your own comments earlier was £50 million for just transition, £42 million for tech scalers, and I know what tech scalers are and so on and so forth, £25 million for Scotland projects, £10 million for hydrogen projects. So there's a kind of variety, and you mentioned a few yourself as well as the 25,000 R100. So how do we show the various regions of Scotland that they're part of this whole strategy and that we're all benefiting? Because you talk about regional inequalities in the framework. So I would certainly expect to see from any further reporting how this reaches the various regions. And I'm sure colleagues will be the same. What's in it for us in our various parts of Scotland? And I'm particularly interested, for example, in Ayrshire and what our slice of this cake actually is. So how would you plan to develop that?
If we could ask Mr. Cook to address that.
I would say that the commitment to regional economic working, the development of regional economic strategies, the role of regional economic partnerships is a distinct theme within the national strategy, and I think it will continue to be over the long term. I think the opportunity that the regional economic partnership in Ayrshire has, for example, to define those priorities and secure investment through the growth deal and other things that it is focused on, I think gives an example of how regions can develop distinct propositions for their area. So I think there is an opportunity to do that, and our commitment is to build on that and to support more and more regional economic thinking and working.
I mean, I appreciate that. But some of these things that I just mentioned a moment ago, they're national spend. That's a national decision, a Scottish decision, a national strategic decision to spend on targeted areas of the economy. So when my constituents knock on my constituency office and say, where's ours? What do I say to them?
Well, I would argue that, and I do think that the regional economic partnership in Ayrshire is developing, and it's the appropriate vehicle to articulate the specific strengths of the regions, the opportunities that you want to address. There is a constant dialogue, or there should be a constant dialogue between those regional economic partnerships that includes, you know, access to all our national programs, all our national agencies, and that they should be making those priorities clear, engaging with us and making the best of the national programs. I mean, national programs hit the ground in a place, in a local area. And so they are looking to support distinct strengths in individual towns and regions and cities.
It's just a plea, and I'm sure other members will agree, that they would like to see this in a regional basis, if at all possible,
yep.
What the shared benefits actually are. Because at the moment, it's kind of difficult to see that. I mean, for the R100, it's easy to see that. We can see that throughout all our constituencies and regions. We can see that. But the bigger picture, it would be appreciated, certainly for me, if that was woven into the fabric of this reporting mechanism, so we can see that. taken place.
Happy to do that, and very keen to do that as part of the reporting, and I'm sure we would look at things like the development of the space cluster around Prestwick as being an example of where a local priority or regional priority has been supported nationally and supported by our agencies, and I hope becomes successful over the longer term.
Great. Thank you very much for that. Thanks, Convener. Thank you.
I mean, I'm going to bring Graham Simpson in, but before I do that, can I just probe into this a little bit more? I mean, does the government have a position about trying to iron out regional imbalances? Does it have a regional policy in that sense or not?
On the economic side, it has a position that says that regional economic working is increasingly important, that one of the roles of government within its long-term economic strategy is to enable those regions to identify those priorities, come up with opportunities. So things like the Glasgow City Innovation District and the Riverside District would be good examples of regional economic priorities translating into meaningful economic initiatives that link to national strategy on things like innovation and entrepreneurship. So yeah, our commitment is to support individual regions to give a voice and make an impact on the basis of priorities that they identify and they decide and that reflect the strengths that they believe are there.
But that's a bit different, isn't it, from a conventional regional policy which might identify Edinburgh as overheating and other parts of the Scottish economy lagging badly behind with higher rates of unemployment, higher rates of worklessness, lower levels of economic activity. I mean, does the Scottish Government take a position on that, or does it not really have that in its sights?
I think it'd be for others to comment on the broader regional economic policy approach of the Scottish Government that goes, as you say, goes far beyond the economy. What I can describe is our commitment to regional working and the way in which agencies, for example, like Highlands and Islands Enterprise, focus explicitly on that region. And we've set up the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency to support the south of Scotland. So from an economic point of view, we have a very clear understanding that regional economies are important, that they are important on a national and indeed an international scale, and one of our roles within the NSET is to support it.
Okay, I'm going to move things along because we are against the clock a little bit and invite Graham Simpson to put some questions to you. Graham.
Thanks a lot, Convener. I think it's been really interesting session so far, a bit frustrating clearly for some of my colleagues. So I'd like to go right back to the beginning, a question that the convener asked and the deputy convener has asked, and I'm not sure what the answer is still. And the question was whether you accept the recommendations of the Auditor General and Mr. Irwin. As the deputy convener recited to you, your answer was not clear. You said that you accepted the broad thrust, but wanted to probe deeper into some of that. And when you answered Mr. Green, I think I heard you say that there was one recommendation, only one, that you weren't too happy with. Is that the only one? And that was the first one. On page 5.
Yes, on page 5, we've already addressed the question of that first bullet point, that first recommendation. But I think the other recommendations on that page, we accept those recommendations. They present challenges to us, but this is, we will take this advice and we will seek to address these recommendations. We will, of course, need to do that at the appropriate time, offering advice to our ministers as to exactly how we do that.
So apart from the first recommendation, you accept all the others and you're going to act on them?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's clear. I don't know why you didn't just say that right at the beginning. But anyway, that's clear now. One of you said, I can't remember whether it was you, Mr. Irwin, or Mr. Griswood, that this is a 10-year strategy. 17 actions have been carried out, 44 are in progress. Is there a list of those?
Yes. And it will be published, the updated list will be published as part of the annual report next month.
So it's not published yet?
I believe was a list published in the previous annual report?
Yeah, so
yes.
The the previous report. So we've given you updated figures on the current status in advance of the end report being published next month.
Okay. Now, again, I'm going to go back to a question the convener asked, where he was essentially railing against government waffle on page 7. I am putting words in the convener's mouth, but that's essentially what he was saying. He couldn't quite get round this government speak. But there was he read out Action 6, create a national system of pre-scalar hubs. Now, I think I know what a pre-scalar hub is. Is that related to, for example, the tech scalar and the code base?
Yes, I mean, the tech scalar focuses explicitly on high growth potential companies and trying to take them to the next scale. Yeah. Or to the next level, and the pre-scaler, and we may look for a more acceptable term, is basic, would effectively be a feeder organization to the tech scaler. So it's something that operates more on a community level, that widens access to entrepreneurship, that makes it easier for people to take the first steps on starting a business.
So it's essentially you're identifying people with what we might call good ideas and helping them to turn that into a business.
People who have that ambition. And again, the NSET talked about creating an entrepreneurial culture and mindset in the country, and that's across all regions, across all communities, and pre-scalers, or however we describe them, are the opportunity, we hope, to get people access to the best possible advice and into the system that now exists in Scotland to support those businesses develop if they wish to, and not all entrepreneurs and not all business leaders do wish to start and scale their businesses, mm-hmm. but give them access to the support and the education they need should they choose to do so.
Okay. And is the chief entrepreneur, Mark Logan, involved in all this?
Mark Logan is intimately involved in all of this, yes. I mean, it's very much an agenda that he's developed alongside ourselves and ministers.
Okay. And I read recently that you have opened up, or maybe it's Mr. Logan, a base in San Francisco. What was the cost of that?
I'm afraid I haven't brought the I haven't got the costs of that with me. That is part of the commitment that's described in NSET to make international links between the entrepreneurial activities in Scotland and give founders and people who are scaling their businesses in Scotland access to the very best education and training and access to the very best opportunities to secure investment. And we believe, and I think most people would accept, that some of the most progressive thinking and many of the biggest companies and the investment is has always been in the Valley, and therefore I think to take Scottish entrepreneurs there is the right thing to do. And Mr. Logan has been talking about maybe repeating that exercise in Singapore, and I even heard I think he's got a twinkle in his eye about Dubai. I mean, these are international ecosystems that are successful in starting and scaling businesses, and we want Scotland to be considered alongside them, and we certainly want our entrepreneurs to draw on the lessons that they have learned.
Yeah, Mr. Logan, he certainly gets about. Can you describe this San Francisco operation? Are you flying Scots out to San Francisco and giving them an office?
We did fly a cohort of entrepreneurs out to San Francisco. There was a pop-up base for them to be part of. I'm afraid I don't have the details about the costs of that. They did engage with fellow entrepreneurs, experiencing the same things as they did. They did engage with investors, and they have proved successful in attracting attention, people coming back into this country and asking questions about the kind of organizations and businesses that we have here. So I think it's been a hugely successful enterprise.
Okay. I mean, can you quantify that? Are you able to provide the committee with some details?
I will come back to the committee on the specifics of that particular program, yes.
Yeah, I think that would be very useful. Okay. Right. Mr. Beattie was asking about funding, and he was very frustrated at the answers that he got. So perhaps I could have a go. Now, so page 13 of the Auditor General's report refers to some areas relating to direct investment by the Scottish Government. So there's a list there. How comprehensive is that list? We got it?
Page 13.
Yeah. The NZ delivery plans include detail of funding commitments for some activities. Some. 50 million for the Just Transition Fund, 42 million for a tech scaler programme, we've just discussed that. 25 million of supply chain investments as part of the ScotWind developments, 10 million hydrogen innovation scheme, 4.7 billion of COVID-19 related business support. Is that it? Or is there more?
There is more, so those are the ones that are specifically quantified, but as I mentioned before, things like, for example, implementing our strategic transport project review conclusions would be billions of pounds on top of that. So there's a series of other things that aren't completely costed. So those are examples of things we've got clear costs on. So the 42 million, for example, on TechScaler is a clear cost. Others are more open-ended or multi-year.
But you haven't got costs for them?
There will be other ones that are in there that we do have costs, but in terms of that being a comprehensive list, that's not a comprehensive list of everything.
So you're able to
within
provide the committee with more information then, with costings.
So we could look at seeing whether there's more specific examples to add to that list now that things have moved on since the delivery plan was published.
Okay, I mean, on the same page, I mean, Mr. Beattie was looking for a figure. It says the NZ annual report references around 9.8 billion of investment for actions. Would that be your budget then, 9.8 billion?
No, so we don't, so I think this is where the budgets that we have in Scottish Government are set out by portfolio, so there isn't a dedicated programme budget for NZ. So each portfolio has a budget, and within that there will be commitments they've made that are NZ actions to take forward.
There's no actual NZ budget.
There's not a dedicated NZ budget, so it's not part of the budget documentation that sets out a dedicated line for NZ. It's done by portfolio. And that's where you also have that discipline around affordability and, you know, and decisions that are made by individual AOs, and hence the need for that portfolio board in order to you bring in those accountable officers from across Scottish Government together, so that when we are putting forward advice to the delivery board and ministers around what we're taking forward, that's informed by what's affordable in those portfolio budgets.
Okay.
And Mr. Simpson, for me, there are good reasons for that. Quite a few of our budget lines are seeking to meet more than one objective. So, for example, Aidan leads on employability funding. That's very directly relevant to our economic objectives, reducing inactivity, also directly relevant to our child poverty objectives. Within that 9.8 billion figure, there will be a significant component is transport investment. That, of course, is an important public service, as well as being directly relevant to NSET. We can look at other areas such as education and skills. The budget for skills provision, again, it's an important public service. Equally, it's also directly relevant to NSET. So in many instances, our budget allocations are seeking to meet more than one objective.
Okie doke. Now, you were asked right at the beginning about this economic leadership group, which hasn't met. So am I right in thinking, just from your answers, that your recommendation will be that this we should just forget this because you've got other things in place?
No. What I've suggested is when you look at the conclusion in the briefing about an absence of political leadership and a lack of an escalation route, that we would suggest that there is both an escalation route and there is political leadership. However, at the same time, 2 years into NSET, given that the Economic Leadership Group has not met before, and given our experience over the past two years, and indeed the political changes that we've seen, now is a good moment to put fresh advice to our ministers on this, and we will set out a range of options to them.
But is your view that we don't need an economic leadership group?
An economic leadership group is one means to provide political leadership of NSET. It is not the only means to provide political leadership
clearly,
of NSET.
Clearly,
and that political leadership has been there over the past 2 years. And I mean, I personally would not fixate too much on the terminology economic leadership group and indeed the proposed membership of that group. It may well be that in the light of experience over the past 2 years, there are better ways to provide that economic leadership, compared to, you know, how it has operated over the past 2 years, or indeed how it was originally proposed. And that is exactly the sort of advice that we want to put to our ministers.
So is it your view that given we've not got this economic leadership group, and by the way, I'm not fixated on it at all, but it was promised, it hasn't met, it doesn't exist. So is it your view that given that that is the case, that we don't need it, we've got other things in place?
I think my view is that good political leadership has been provided by other means.
Yeah.
But 2 years in, and in the light of experience, it may well be that we can improve on that. We can make it more efficient, we can make it more impactful, and it's a good opportunity to take stock and provide fresh advice to our ministers on this question.
Okay, I think that's clear enough. Right, I've just got, if you just bear with me, I've got a final question. Get to it. Sorry, convener, did have it. No, I think I've covered everything, convener.
Okay, right, thank you. Can I then just ask a question about progress with plans to update the NSET? Where are we with that? Because I know that we've spoken a few times this morning about the reset and refreshing, and I completely understand the turbulent political times and the changes that there are may have inhibited the extent to which you can answer some of the questions firmly. But could you tell us what your expectation is about the timescales and what the scope of the update is likely to be?
So the original timescale, as we set out, was we were looking towards publishing our conclusions around September of this year. I think both the question of the timing and the scope of the refresh and how extensive that is, these are precisely the sort of questions that we need to raise with our new ministerial team. I'm afraid I can't preempt that. Obviously, I have a good understanding of previous cabinet secretaries' views of this, and this is something that needs to be addressed with the new ministerial team at the appropriate time in the appropriate way. But that timing is still very feasible. And indeed, we will have the launch of the annual report, the publication of the annual report in June, and that will potentially provide a moment to go into a bit more detail on the nature of this work. But this is a decision that our new Cabinet Secretary, the Deputy First Minister, will need to take, and we've not yet been able to have that, to offer that advice to her.
Okay, I mean, I do reflect on the fact that one of the recommendations is about clearer timescales as well as clearer targets. And I think we would all welcome a greater clarity over the future of the strategy, what it's going to look like and when we're going to be able to rejoin a public debate about it, because it isn't just the property of government, is it? It's about engagement with other stakeholders that will deliver it. I mean, if we are genuine about wanting to see a transformative change in the economy, then that's going to demand popular support right across the board to achieve that. I'm going to close this morning's session now. There are a number of areas where you've agreed, I think, to provide us with further written information. And as I always say, we prefer to get accurate information rather than speculative information from our witnesses. So we very much appreciate that you will provide us with that information timeously. Can I thank you, all three of you, for the evidence that you have given us this morning. So Director General Colin Cook and Aidan Griswood, can I thank each of you for your time and the information that you have been able to supply us with. And I will now move the committee into private session. Thank you very much.